Wavesound Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of In the Dead of Night, a mysterious disappearance, a brazen murderer, and the police who hunted him down. Written by Greg Haddrick, narrated by David Tredinnick. Epigraph. In March 2020, two lovers in their 70s disappeared in Victoria's Wonnangatta Valley. What happened? Who do you believe? And why? 1. Over the skies of Victoria's high country in southeastern Australia, the moon began its final quarter on Monday, the 16th of March, 2020. By Friday, it was a mere fingernail clipping of unpolished silver, with no power to penetrate the cloud cover spreading south. Throughout the Wonnangatta Valley, every camper could sense the dark night ahead and brought their nervy companions in close to share teeth-chattering stories that would scare the sash off a sumo wrestler. It was a tradition of camping, frighten the newbies around the dying campfire. By 8 o'clock, the night was starless. The last cicadas of summer fell silent. The air was still. From our earliest days in the African savannah, humans have learnt to survive by being more sensually alert during the night. Our eyesight evolved for daytime. We hunted with colour and depth perception, and gathered and gossiped and formed bonds of trust as the sun shone, and it served us well. But our predators waited till night. In the darkness, they knew we were weak. To see dawn, we had to be wary, quiet and cautious. 2. In March 2020, the head of the Victoria Police Missing Persons Squad was Detective Inspector Andrew Stamper. Stamper is a casual, easy-talking copper who has fronted his fair share of press briefings without attracting a public profile of any note, except with crime reporters and aficionados. But he has proved remarkably effective. He has an engaging turn of phrase and an amusingly dry sense of humour, which makes him very easy to like. With short, curly black hair, a solid and imposing 1.88-metre frame and a laconic drawl, he has a knack for winning and keeping friends. His parents are from the north of England, but Stamps is an Aussie and a veteran major crime and homicide detective with Victoria Police, VicPol. He was one of a couple of dozen key detectives in Task Force Purana, whose work ended the Melbourne gangland war of 2000 to 2004. He has pursued, arrested, interviewed and convicted dozens of serious offenders, and several of those can be counted among Australia's most cunning, intelligent criminal psychopaths. He has also been presented with a vast range of puzzling crime scenes, as well as many that were not so puzzling but just enormously tragic. After the completion of the investigation into the murder of 23-year-old comedian and actress Eurydice Dixon in an inner-city Melbourne park, a particularly shocking case that Stamper also led, he moved from homicide to the missing persons squad, where, theoretically, confronting cases with a high media profile were less likely. In early March 2020, the appeal launched by James Todd, Dixon's 19-year-old killer, against the severity of his sentence was finally dismissed. He would spend his life behind bars. The final chapter in that sad, horrific story was closed, and Stamps enjoyed a fortnight's refreshing leave before returning to work at the missing persons squad. Right there and then, he was confronted with a series of photos that the local detectives from the Wellington Crime Investigation Unit, based in the regional town of Sale, had been sharing with his team in his absence. They depicted a mysterious burnt-out campsite and a white Toyota Land Cruiser four-wheel drive that had been found after a retired logger had been reported missing. The contrast with the Eurydice Dixon case was stark. For the time being, the local detective in charge of the investigation was Amy Frost, an officer of some note in the tight-knit world of policing due to the impressive haul of gold medals she had won snowboarding and slalom skiing at the Australian Police Games the previous winter. Over the last couple of days, Amy had been assembling a summary of facts about the missing retired logger, and sharing these with one of Andy Stamper's investigators, Detective Senior Constable Abby Justin. In the spare, rather clinical conference room where the missing persons squad was located, on the fourth floor of the headquarters of VicPol in Spencer Street, Melbourne, Abby began bringing Stamps up to speed. The Land Cruiser belonged to the logger, a 74-year-old man named Russell Hill, who lived in the Victorian town of Druin with his wife, Robin. Russell had told Robin he was going camping for a few days in the Wonnangatta Valley, which he often did. Having spent much of his life as a forestry worker, Russell was a tough old nut who loved the outdoors. Years earlier, he had helped cut the switchbacks on the now much-travelled Zika Spur track, one of the few steep, awkward, unsealed four-wheel drive pathways leading from the comforts of modern civilization into the no-tech wilderness of the Wonnangatta Valley. Russell was also an experienced and responsible bushy. When he was travelling in areas with no phone reception, he would regularly connect with his circle of radio enthusiasts at 6 p.m. He kept a receiver at home, and his wife could listen in to these calls if she wished. Robin wasn't licensed to make a call, but she could, and often did, switch the receiver on around 6 p.m. and check that Russell was okay. These safety calls were part of an unwritten law that Russell's small group of like-minded campers adhered to religiously whenever any of them was off the grid. Around 6 p.m. on Friday, the 20th of March, 2020, Russell did just that. Using his amateur radio on frequency 3.670 with a call sign VK3VZP, he reported to his friends Mike Allen and Rob Ashland that he was camping near where he and Rob had camped before. A friendly chat about the newly graded Zika Spur track. "It's like a highway," Russell said happily, which Robin also heard, ended with Rob giving Russell detailed instructions on what paths heading east would take him out to the Dargo High Plains Road. Sounding as pleased as a pig in shit, Russell signed off saying, VK3VZP from Wonnangatta Station. That was the last time anyone heard anything from Russell Hill. When Rob didn't get a call from him again on the Saturday, Sunday or Monday, he thought it odd. Just a bit. Not too much. He and Robin exchanged a few calls discussing this. Was Russell on tonight?
No.
It was a little strange. Maybe the radio was broken. In normal times, Rob might have acted faster, although he knew Russell had planned to be away until at least the 24th or 25th. But these weren't normal times. This was March 2020, and everyone in the world was being distracted by the emerging coronavirus and its potentially catastrophic effect on Earth's human population. Earlier that Saturday, on the 21st of March, Victorian Premier Dan Andrews had announced a $1.7 billion economic survival package for businesses affected by the restrictions that had been imposed due to the growing pandemic. Already, some non-essential gatherings of more than 500 people had been banned. The next day, a shutdown of some non-essential services commenced, and school holidays were brought forward. On Wednesday, the 25th of March, Stage 2 restrictions commenced, which spread the national shutdown to all non-essential businesses and services. In the middle of all this panic, Rob called Robin.
"We haven't heard from Russell for 4 nights now. Something's not right. I think you better go to the cops."
That Wednesday, after Russell missed yet another 6 p.m. radio chat, Robin called 000 and reported her husband missing. The emergency responder suggested Robin make a report in person to Warragul Police Station, which he did early on Thursday, the 26th of March. Could someone check on Russell? Maybe he'd gone off track, had an accident, be needing help. Who knew? The police agreed it sounded unusual. They requested a recent photo of Russell and reorganised their rosters in preparation for a journey up to Wonnangatta. The police station closest to the Wonnangatta Valley was Mafra, more than 100 kilometres away. And on Friday, the 27th of March, two junior officers from Mafra climbed into a VicPol four-wheel drive and drove the 2.5 hours to the Wonnangatta Valley. Russell's photo began to appear on social media sites and in newspapers that hit the state's petrol stations and news agencies just as Mafra police were conducting the first search for him, which in truth was mostly an exercise in making initial inquiries. Perhaps there was an innocent explanation, one that speaking to people still camping near Russell's last known location would reveal. Beyond that, it was difficult for the police to know exactly what they were looking for, or exactly where they should look. Russell could have driven anywhere in the whole Alpine National Park on the Saturday, or the Sunday, or the Monday, or Tuesday. So where should they even start? The officers stood on the small corridor of open grassland stretching away from the ruins of the old Wonnangatta homestead and pondered the area they'd have to search. The Wonnangatta Valley was only one section of the full Alpine National Park. The park itself was a vast area of intimidating Australian bush, bigger than Belgium. As they travelled through the valley, they spoke to campers, rangers, and trail bike riders, asking if anyone had seen a gentleman in his 70s, or his white Land Cruiser. Perhaps someone could help them narrow the search down to something approximating a manageable area? Unfortunately, no one could. No one had seen anything. Nonetheless, the two officers had raised awareness. One of the campers they spoke to, 68-year-old Colin Boyd, had a good reason to remember his chat with them a couple of hours later when he pulled off the Wonnangatta track into a clearing known to locals as Buck's Camp. Colin quickly hit the anchors and stared at what lay ahead. Sitting on the grass was a white Land Cruiser in front of a blue-tinted portable toilet. The Land Cruiser had scorch marks down the canopy on its left-hand side, and the left-wing mirror had been broken off. Or had been torn off or shot off. At any rate, it was off. But that was the least of the damage. From the side of the Land Cruiser, extending 5 or 6 metres to the left, lay the remnants of a tent and a large collection of camping equipment. Gas bottles, fold-out chairs, solar panels, a portable table and a battery, all of which had been savagely burnt and now lay scattered on the ground in a silent, flattened field of ash. There were no people around, no one that Colin could see, anyway. But that simply added to his sense of creepiness as he took in the scene before him. While Colin didn't know if this was Russell Hill's camp, the white Land Cruiser did fit the description of Russell's vehicle, and nothing about this site looked right. It looked like it hadn't been lived in since the fire. There was no rubbish, and all the cooking utensils and chairs were inside the burnt tent. Using a simple iPhone app, Colin grabbed the GPS coordinates of the site and then took a couple of snaps. But there was no cellular data reception in the valley. To contact police, Colin had to drive back up the Zika Spur track towards Howard Plains. As soon as his phone had a bar, he called the police, explained what he'd discovered, passed on the exact GPS coordinates of Buck's camp, and then texted through the photos he'd taken. The on-duty crime scene services officer for Wellington, which encompassed the MAFRA and SAIL units, was Sergeant Matt Tanner. He immediately saw the number plate on the Land Cruiser. Yes, this was Russell's car. Okay, so that was the camp. And there'd been a fire. And what? What did it mean? Early the next morning, the 28th of March, leading senior constable Chris Skiba refuelled the MAFRA police four-wheel drive and swung by Hayfield Station. After picking up senior constable Madeline Ratchford, he began the long drive to Wonnangatta. At around the same time as this was happening, a woman phoned SAIL police, asking to speak to someone on the team looking for Russell Hill. Given they had done a media call-out the previous day, this was not unusual. When an appeal is made to the public often responds. The result can be dozens or hundreds of information reports. Typically, most are easily categorised as either irrelevant or as low priority, but warranting later follow-up. But
After listening for less than a minute to this woman, the duty constable quickly realised she was genuine.
Who's calling?
Vicky Birch, came the answer, from the Pakenham Country Women's Association. She was very worried. Was there any news of Carol? She asked.
What?
Was it Carol who reported Russell missing? Is she all right?
Wait, what? Who?
Carol Clay.
Who's Carol Clay?
Russell's... Well, you know, she was with him.
With Russell?
Yes.
But his wife said he was on his own.
Well, maybe that's what his family thought, said Vicky, but Carol had called Vicky on Thursday morning. From Russell's car. Just after Russell had picked her up. She was really excited. She had arranged to go on a cruise with her sister, but when that got cancelled because of this coronavirus thing, Russell had said, let's go camping instead. They'd planned to go away for the weekend and were due to return on Monday. Just him and her. Or at least that's what Carol had told Vicky. But all subsequent calls to Carol's phone had gone straight to voicemail for the last 3 days. Did they know if she was okay? Vicky was asked a few standard questions, like what was Carol's mobile number, her address, was she married?
Divorced.
Any other close friends or next of kin who could verify this? A short time later, Carol's sister, Jill, confirmed she had exchanged emails with Carol on the night of Wednesday, the 18th of March. Jill had wanted to check that Carol had cancelled her flight to Sydney. They had both booked to fly to Sydney on the Thursday to board the Ruby Princess for a Pacific cruise. But the federal government had banned all cruises on the 15th of March, just hours after the Ruby Princess had left New Zealand bound for Sydney, where it would dock on the 19th of March with 900 cases of COVID-19 that would eventually result in 28 deaths. With the plug pulled on their cruise, Jill said, reiterating Vicky's account, Carol had been packing up to spend a few days in the bush with Russell. Earlier that same day that Jill and Carol had been emailing, the Victorian Premier, Dan Andrews, had announced a ban on indoor gatherings of more than 100 people in response to the coronavirus pandemic. As cases and deaths surged, everyone could see a lockdown coming, and Carol and Russell, like so many others, were keen to enjoy their last days of freedom before the restrictions became severe. As she relayed all this information, Jill was embarrassed on Carol's behalf because her secret relationship with Russell had been going on for quite a few years now. Jill thought it was secret anyway. She didn't think Russell's wife knew. Jill had told Carol more than once how concerned she was about Carol and Russell, two septuagenarians going camping together out of phone range, but the couple had decided it was the best way to keep the relationship secret. Now Jill, like Vicky, was worried that all her worst fears were about to be realised. Next, detectives from Sale drove out to see Robin Hill, dreading the conversation they had to have with Robin and her daughters.
Do you know a Carol Clay?
Yes, why?
Did you know or suspect that Carol had accompanied Russell on many of his camping trips over the last few years, including this last one?
The blood drained from Robin's face. She hadn't had the slightest inkling. Hearing that Russell had taken Carol on secret tented sleepovers was a total surprise. She'd thought he hadn't seen her for over a decade. And now it was going to be splashed across all the papers and leading every news bulletin. Suddenly, there were two missing Wonnangatta Valley campers, 74-year-old Russell Hill and 73-year-old Carol Clay. The couple had been in the middle of some form of extramarital relationship when they had disappeared. The public appeal expanded. Had anyone seen either Russell or Carol, or both of them, anywhere? For Robin Hill, it lifted the trauma beyond the bearable. She was left to cope with a missing husband, a relationship betrayal, and the immediate national exposure of both. Understandably, she withdrew from public view. Who could blame her?
From now on, the police and media would primarily liaise with Russell and Robin's daughters, Colleen, Debbie, and Jenny. 3. Matt Tanner met with leading senior constable Greg Cogan at Hayfield a little after midday on the 28th of March. Greg knew his way around the Wonnangatta Valley, so Matt would follow him up and then together they would process the crime scene. Meanwhile, Madeline Ratchford and Chris Skeeber arrived at Buck's camp to secure the site. The scene had been untouched since Colin Boyd had found it the previous day. Not being trained crime scene services officers, they proceeded carefully. The Land Cruiser's cabin was locked, but the rear canopy was not. The scorch marks on the canopy could have been the result of an effort to burn off blood, but it was impossible to say. A guy rope tied to the front bull bar was connected to a portable toilet tent. The toilet tent was about a metre in front of the Land Cruiser and had survived unscathed. It appeared not to have been used. Robin had told the police about a small compartment behind the car's cabin where Russell kept a spare key. Locating that key, they opened the cabin. There was a wallet in each footwell. The wallets had been emptied of cash, while the cards had been removed and left on the floor. There was no sign of Russell's or Carol's mobile phones, nor was there any sign of Russell or Carol themselves. Nothing had been touched for days. Even the king parrots and cockatoos were giving the site a wide berth. There was just silence. Matt Tanner and Greg Cogan arrived a little after 5 p.m. Greg began videoing each section of the scene in detail on his phone, and then they fanned out in a radius of about 100 metres from the campsite, but still they found nothing. They took many photos of the site and the debris, but they were careful to disturb as little as possible, preserving the site for the forensic scientists. Organising the logistics needed to transport a fully equipped forensics team up to such a remote location, only accessible by four-wheel drives or trail bikes, would have been tough at the best of times. It was made exponentially more difficult, however, by the Victorian government announcing Stage 3 coronavirus restrictions on Monday, the 30th of March, effective immediately. People could only leave their homes for four reasons: to obtain food and supplies, for medical care, for exercise, and for work or education. Gatherings of more than two people were banned unless they were members of the same household. These restrictions applied to police and police activities. Many police were granted exemptions, but many were not. Police could hardly enforce these rules on the public if they all simply carried on normally themselves. In the blink of an eye, Sale Police Station was reduced to a skeleton crew. But Matt Tanner still called in Amy Frost, the gold medal winning young detective with the Wellington Crime Investigation Unit. He gave her a handover briefing on the missing couple in the Wonnangatta Valley. For the next couple of weeks, at least, while some other police started working from home, Amy began coordinating the permissions needed to enable the force to access and track Russell's and Carol's bank statements, credit cards, and phone records. Over the coming days and weeks, these would be used as the proof of life checks. Amy also contacted the arson squad and the forensics department and sought their assistance in processing the scene. On Wednesday, the 1st of April, a search and rescue team led by Senior Sergeant Greg Paul and a forensic team led by George Zidius finally arrived at Buck's camp. The brand new rules of social distancing were strictly followed, slowing everything. Pubs and cafes were closed in the cities, footy games were cancelled, and toilet paper was sold out. But Zidius was still able to begin combing over the remote burnt-out campsite with an arson chemical team. Alarmingly, there was no evidence of Russell or Carol at all. Their sleeping bags and mobile phones were missing, as was Russell's new drone. Drone? That did pique the team's interest. By this time, Amy had visited both Carol's family and Russell's family. Russell's daughters had told police their dad had been particularly chuffed with that purchase.
He had even created a special spot for the drone in the storage compartment under the Land Cruiser's canopy. Now there was no sign of it. But then all of Russell's camping equipment had been thrown inside the tent and set ablaze. Apart from charred remains, they found nothing. No hair, clothes, or fingerprints. Not a thing. It looked like everything had been burnt and then left alone. The forensic team carefully collected as much debris as they could from the burnt campsite and brought Russell's Land Cruiser back to the police evidence compound at Aerial Towing in Mafra. On closer examination there, they found medical prescriptions for antidepressants belonging to Russell and a map of Wonnangatta that clearly showed the areas where deer hunting was allowed and where it was not. But determining if there was any microscopic evidence of value among all the charred fragments from the campsite would be difficult until they knew what they were looking for, and was made even more difficult by lockdown-related delays. At this point, forensics could offer little help to investigators. Two people were missing. That was it. They could not even say with any accuracy when the fire had happened. It really could have been any time in the 6 days between Russell's last radio contact with Rob Ashland and Colin Boyd's discovery of the burnt campsite and Russell's Land Cruiser. A little after 1 p.m. on the 1st of April, Amy attended a high-level meeting where she briefed senior officers on the status of the investigation. But what the investigators needed was a breakthrough. Anything to give them a start. Then, on the 8th of April, Freya Marquardt called. Her husband had a photo of the burnt campsite, from the weekend before last. She was transferred straight through to Amy Frost. "When was your husband in the Wonnangatta Valley?" Amy asked. "On the Saturday, like the 20th, 21st. 21st? Yeah. "When? Any idea what time?"
"About 11 o'clock or so."
"In the morning?"
"Yeah. Then he went back on the Sunday and took a couple of photos too, if you'd like to see them."
"Please, yes."
"What was it like? The campsite? The same as the photo in the papers?"
"It was already burnt?"
"Yeah, just like the photo. It was cold too, no smoke or embers."
"But there was no sign of Russell or Carol?"
"No one for miles, apparently. Andrew figured they must have gone for help or got a lift with someone else."
Amy radioed a message through to Greg Paul's Search and Rescue HQ in Lacola as the teams up in the Wonnangatta Valley were embarking on an extended search through the surrounding bush, most of which is dense forest. Given the added difficulty imposed by social distancing, everyone knew they were in for a bit of a slog, and their hopes of finding Russell and Carol alive, never high, plummeted on hearing the fire must have happened at least 18 days ago. Still, they could be alive. Nothing could be completely discounted yet. A big team had been assembled, including local cattlemen and specially trained cadaver dogs on loan from the New South Wales Police. If Russell and Carol had gone for an evening stroll, and one of them had tripped, maybe, sprained an ankle, in the darkness, that could have proved costly. It was an early and obvious theory, but several facts played against it. Russell's camping mate, Rob Ashland, pointed out that Russell was a very careful, experienced camper and would never have wandered beyond line of sight of his camp at night. The possibility something would be stolen was far too great. Added to this, Jill had told the police her sister Carol was a severe asthmatic who could barely walk 50 metres without needing several puffs of Ventolin. The notion that these two 70-year-olds would suddenly choose to go for a bush hike on a moonless night seemed extremely unlikely. And even if they had, who had then put all their equipment inside the tent and burnt it to the ground? Long experience had also taught Greg Paul and his team that if the elderly couple had wandered off and got lost, they would have been wearing boots, puffer jackets, jeans, and other clothing. And if dogs or other wild animals had been responsible for their demise, they almost certainly would have found some remains. But a meticulous search,
taking nearly 2 weeks and extending 10 kilometres from the campsite, revealed nothing. Not a skerrick. Russell and Carol had simply vanished. By mid-April, the chance they were lost or injured and needing to be rescued was dismissed as being so unlikely it was virtually impossible. Of course, the two had been conducting a secret affair, and the possibility they had simply eloped to set up a new life together remained popular with lifestyle magazine journos and tabloid television presenters, and the general public, for months. The romantic theory that Russell and Carol had found true love late in life and decided to leave all their family and friends behind to pursue a quiet, totally off-the-grid relationship, happy in each other's arms, was an irresistible story to many. But neither family seriously believed it. Russell had bought his new, gleaming white Toyota Land Cruiser less than a month before. It had cost him close to $80,000, and it was his most prized possession. The idea that he would simply abandon it was unimaginable. Added to this, Russell's three girls were all close to their dad, and Russell had left saying he was looking forward to seeing them as soon as he returned. Assuming that all that talk was a lie, and he was really planning to run off with Carol and never see or speak to his daughters again, didn't make much sense. It could never be completely discounted, but it was not likely. And Carol had recently bought a new home in Pakenham with the money she had received after a long, drawn-out divorce from her husband. The purchase had just been settled, and she had moved into her new home only 2 months earlier. Carol had been so relieved and thrilled to finally have her own place that her sister Jill found it inconceivable that she would suddenly decide to lock the door, walk out, and leave all that behind. Privately, the police agreed. Neither Russell's nor Carol's credit cards or bank accounts had been touched. Neither had squirreled away any nest eggs into other accounts. If they had eloped, what they were living on was a mystery. But, given the police motto was, keep an open mind, they pledged they would. They were fond of saying, and Melbourne crime journo extraordinaire John Sylvester is fond of repeating, that their minds were like parachutes. They only worked when they were open. But they were increasingly convinced that in reality, they were facing a crime scene. Russell had put his last radio call in on the 20th of March. By the next day, according to Freya Marquardt's husband, his burnt campsite was already cold and his Land Cruiser abandoned. Whatever had happened in the dead of night on Friday, the 20th of March. And it had very likely, it now appeared, cost Russell and Carol their lives. By the middle of April, any chance of an early breakthrough was long gone. The search and rescue team had come up empty-handed, and the local detectives at Sale knew there was little more they could do. It was time to transfer the matter to those with much deeper resources and a higher level of experience. Abby Justin and Brett Florence from VicPol's Missing Persons Squad arrived at Sale for the handover on the 13th of April. Amy Frost outlined all the known facts, such as they were at the time, what they'd found at the site, what they'd found in Russell's car, the initial public response to the media call-out. And they had just received the first batch of data from Russell's phone carrier that showed what towers his phone had connected with as he drove east from Pakenham to the Wonnangatta Valley on the 19th of March. The phone data stopped around midday as he and Carol left Howard Plains and headed down into the valley where there was no reception. There was nothing from either Russell's phone or Carol's phone on the next day. Tantalisingly, on the morning of the 21st of March, Russell's phone had connected to the Telstra cellular tower at Dinner Plain, then the tower at Mount Hotham for what at this stage seemed to be about 22 minutes, then the Mount Buffalo tower for about 4 hours. After that, nothing. Apart from that small detail, they had no other phone data, no nearby Vic Roads cameras, no CCTV, no DNA, no fingerprints,
nothing. No real clue whatsoever.
Abby and Brett stayed at Sale for 2 days, making sure they took in all the information available. Then Abby briefly shook hands with the Sale officers, flashed a warm smile, and left with Brett. The road back to Melbourne took them past Russell's home in Druin, and then Carol's home in Pakenham. They stopped at both, first to introduce themselves. Abby would now become the liaison contact for both families. And second, to take possession of items that could provide DNA profiles for Russell, his shaver, and Carol, her toothbrush.
Good luck, thought Amy, as her notes on the biggest mystery she'd ever encountered walked out of her life, tucked under Abby's arm. She couldn't imagine how in hell they were going to solve this one.
4. The VicPol Missing Persons Squad is a division of homicide. Let's get that straight from the outset. It doesn't investigate reports of unruly teenagers who've just nicked some cash or a card and flounced off to flip a finger at authority. Local police deal with that. Matters are referred to the Missing Persons Squad when it looks more than likely foul play is involved. If a body is found and an unlawful killing is suspected, the case goes to homicide. If a body is not found and an unlawful killing is suspected, the case goes to the Missing Persons Squad. The MPS had been monitoring this matter for 3 weeks, but it wasn't till mid-April that the police hierarchy deemed it to be their case. Although the squad had effectively taken control of the investigation on the 13th of April, they weren't officially in charge until the 20th of April. From then on, it was theirs. It would be called Operation Lexicon. Andy Stamper would supervise the overall investigation from a command perspective, but the informant, the team leader who would be responsible for formally charging anyone arrested over the matter, was Abby Justin. Her initial team included Brett Florence and Candace Robson. Other members of the Missing Persons Squad would also stay across the investigation and help when needed. At the relatively young age of 34, bright, dark-haired Abby Justin had already assembled quite a CV. An alumna of St. Aloysius College, she had graduated from La Trobe University in 2008 with degrees in social work and human services. Her first employer was the Department of Human Services in Footscray, where she had worked as a child protection practitioner in the reunification team. After a few years, she had decided on a different career and graduated from the Police Academy in 2011. She was posted to Altona North, where she investigated motor vehicle theft and drug offences, before completing detective training and being appointed to the Footscray Sexual Offences and Child Abuse Investigation Team. In 2017, she was selected to take part in a program working with at-risk youth. They trained every Sunday for 3 months, and then together they walked the Kokoda Trail. For those who don't know the Kokoda Trail, it was the route the Japanese advanced through New Guinea in World War II before being pushed back by Australian forces. It is now a physically draining, character-building, unforgettable 100-kilometre challenge through tropical rainforests. By the time Abby moved to the Missing Persons Squad in 2019, those experiences had given her impressive strength and confidence. Brett Florence, on the other hand, while just as strong and confident, bore an uncanny resemblance to most people's stereotypical idea of the seasoned police detective. A middle-aged white guy with thinning, short-cropped silver hair. But beneath that unremarkable appearance was an unflappable, observant, highly skilled operator who was famous for caring deeply about victims and their families. Inside his bulldog build, Brett possessed a no-nonsense intelligence. In terms of the public interface between the media and the Missing Persons Squad, though, the point guard would primarily be the overall supervisor, Andrew Stamper. At his first stand-up, as the cops call their press conferences, on the morning of the 22nd of April, Stamps was open and honest. "We really don't know what has caused Russell and Carol's disappearance," he stated bluntly.
Foul play can't be ruled out, but neither can it be ruled in. However, there are a number of areas that concern us. Clearly, one of them is that, from what we know of Russell and Carol, it is unlikely they would have gone on a bushwalk or a hike away from their camp. If they did, given the extent of the search we've carried out so far, we assume the two of them would have been found. But it is an unforgiving environment. You don't have to move far from the cleared area in the Wonnangatta Valley to find yourself in very rough terrain. Andy went on to explain that through tracking Russell's and Carol's phones from cellular tower to cellular tower, investigators knew the route Russell had taken to the valley. Through Hayfield, up to Lacola, Lacola North, then through Howard Plains and on to the Zika Spur track, which then leads into the Wonnangatta Valley. Mobile phone reception becomes pretty problematic past Lacola, and there is no coverage at all in the Wonnangatta Valley itself. It was a forbidding and remote place to the uninitiated. In a direct appeal to the community, Andy asked for anyone who lived around the area or had been visiting the area between the 20th and the 24th of March with any form of CCTV, whether a security camera for a home or business or dash cam footage from a car, to please contact police. He was asked about the nature of Russell and Carol's relationship, but he would not be drawn into speculation on that issue, other than to state that the eloping theory of their disappearance was not credible. It was clear that several corners of the press were more curious about a secret affair between two septuagenarians than they were about the possibility of a double murder. Both families released statements to coincide with the missing persons squad's widely reported appeal to the public. Russell's daughters were devastated that no one could tell them what had happened to their dad. Jill, Carol's sister, spoke of the continual stress of dealing with an absolute mystery. She had known immediately something was wrong, and the more she looked at the photo of the abandoned Land Cruiser and the cindered campsite, the more she felt something awful had been pre-planned. But why would someone premeditate such a vile act? Had they suffered? Had they been conscious? Aware? Were there final moments in the dark Wonnangatta night, moments of terror? The investigators, too, felt that, based more on common sense than anything else at that point, the campsite had been burnt by a person, or people, for the purpose of covering their tracks. The big question was, who? The police already had several reports from park rangers and Wonnangatta locals that helpfully suggested various possibilities. The fact that Russell had a drone had begun to circulate, and many a wild imagination had been stirred by thoughts of what that drone might have stumbled across. A marijuana crop, perhaps. What if they had accidentally discovered a drug cartel whose boss had kidnapped or killed them? One local was considered by many to be a likely suspect. This was the infamous Button Man, a shadowy, elusive and feared local hermit who lived a solitary existence in various hidden camps in the remote corners of the Alpine National Park and occasionally terrorised campers who strayed too close to his haunts. Abby, Brett and Candace had to begin somewhere. Normally, finding initial evidence wouldn't present a huge problem. In the modern world of near-blanket electronic tracking and surveillance tools, 21st century police usually have an array of capabilities enabling them to uncover a considerable amount of evidence in a very short space of time. In the Eurydice Dixon case, for example, within 24 hours of her body being discovered, Andy's team had found CCTV footage of James Todd stalking Eurydice through inner Melbourne. But in the Wonnangatta Valley, they had next to nothing. The fact that Russell's phone had connected to the Telstra cellular towers at Dinner Plain and Mount Hotham on the morning of Saturday, the 21st of March, for about 22 minutes, they had not made public, and they quickly decided they wouldn't. They happily released data about Russell's phone collected on the days before the 20th of March, when he was heading into the valley, but nothing about this batch of data after the 20th of March. They also knew it had then connected to the Mount Buffalo Tower for about another 4 hours. A reasonable interpretation of this data suggested the phone had moved through the range of the Dinner Plain Tower into the Mount Hotham Tower and then into the range of the Mount Buffalo Tower. Then it stopped moving. In time, this piece of evidence might prove critical or irrelevant. But while there was still a chance it could be critical, it would stay a tightly held secret. That was it. There was no other clue. On average, cellular towers have a reception range of around 30 to 40 kilometres. Working from home, Brett printed off a map, got out an old-fashioned compass, screwed in his pencil, and drew a 40-kilometre circle around the Dinner Plain Tower, which was where the phone had first come into range. It was an area of more than 5,000 square kilometres. At the moment, all he could say was that for 22 minutes, Russell's phone had travelled somewhere inside that circle, and then northwest towards Mount Buffalo. And then what? What were the scenarios they had to consider and eliminate? Either the battery had died, or the phone had moved out of range again. Had Russell been with the phone? Had he and Carol staged their disappearance and eloped to live their twilight years in blissful union off the grid? Or had the phone been carried into range by someone else? Had someone just found Russell's phone somewhere and picked it up? And if Russell had been with the phone, was he dead? Were the bodies of Russell and Carol somewhere in that circle? And if they were, where did the squad start looking in the 5,000 square kilometres? If the phone's battery still had life, they could triangulate its position, even if the phone was turned off. Brett emailed one of the team's intelligence analysts. Can Telstra's data pinpoint the direction the ping came from? Think so. Depends how many aerials are on the base station. Great. Might take a week or two. They'll have to dig deep into the metadata. Well, let's just be polite. Ask nicely. See how quick they can move. Okay. With zero forensic evidence and zero electronic or communications evidence, they were in a highly unusual position for a modern police investigation. For the first time in years, Abby and Brett were starting with absolutely nothing other than a 6 to 10 hour time frame in which an event had occurred. But the offender, or offenders, if what had happened was an offence, could have entered the valley at any time and left at any time, or still be there. The Wonnangatta Valley hosted many weekend campers and trail bike riders, but many people stayed there for a week or two, or three. The eccentric button man often stayed bush for months, and he had been connected to three other disappearances over the previous few years, at least in the public imagination. He was clearly a scary character, but evidence of him being a violent character was more anecdotal. Nonetheless, at the moment, he had to be on a list of possible suspects. Had anyone seen him, even briefly, that weekend? Was there any sort of information to suggest he might be involved? Not yet. Then again, there was hardly any information about anything at all. In the months that followed, Andy and Brett would liken this investigation to assembling a 1,000-piece jigsaw puzzle without having the box lid to show you what the picture was. But they had to start somewhere. Trying to account for everyone would be a daunting task. Yet what else could they do? It would be hard and exhausting, but the plan was to identify each person who had been in the valley that weekend. They began with another public appeal. They asked anyone who had been there to come forward so they could start identifying who they were and where they had camped. In particular, they were appealing to anyone who may have had a dash cam operating. Any vision of vehicles in the area would be invaluable. They also asked for assistance from many local businesses, like Reedy's Recovery, the small Mansfield company that was constantly being called into the valley to rescue and tow out bogged vehicles.
none of these parts of inquiry yielded anything useful. All they had was the Telstra connection data, and they were still waiting on the answers it might have. What direction had the signal come from? Was it moving? How fast? Was someone walking with it or driving with it? Could the movement be tracked? The exact timing established? The distance pinpointed? The response to all of the above was, yes, theoretically. But it would require fiendishly difficult technical know-how to dig deeper and deeper into the information. And first, they had to go through the paperwork needed to be able to give Telstra the authority to release that data to police. After that, the squad had to find an expert in digital forensic telecommunications with enough time on their hands to accept the task of crunching the numbers and supplying the answers. Very few people in the country had the expertise to find all those answers, and most of them were working on high-priority tasks for the military. Getting the information they needed could take months and cost a fortune. Stamps and Brett knew there was a chance the phone had just been innocently picked up by someone and then tossed away. The only information they had for sure was that, on the morning of Saturday, the 21st of March, a couple of hours before Andrew Marquardt stumbled across the already cold, burnt-out campsite at Buck's Camp, Russell's phone had been turned on and carried, taken, driven, thrown in range of a tower. But it had moved from the campsite. It had been detected about 100 kilometres from the campsite. That was all. Yet, with so little else to go on, they had to take the plunge and commit to finding out what they could from the metadata, however long it took. Over May and June 2020, the investigation progressed in fits and starts. The first big COVID-19 lockdown in Victoria meant investigators were having to continue under trying circumstances. Many had been granted exemptions, but some were working from home, and those with children were stuck homeschooling energetic kids as they scheduled Zoom conversations with the people who had come forward and volunteered what they had seen in the valley that weekend. Everyone they contacted was shown a picture of Russell's Land Cruiser. Ring a bell? The first couple of people shook their heads blankly. Nope, not particularly. I mean, we might have passed it. We passed at least half a dozen four-wheel drives. It doesn't stand out, though. Abby Justin, at home and going nowhere, made a cup of tea and listened to the latest COVID-19 report from Victoria's Chief Health Officer, Brett Sutton, while she waited for her next Zoom appointment. How fast could the world get a vaccine? At that stage, no one knew. It was just surreal. She sat down at her computer and opened the link. Zoom was new to everyone at this point, but it was rapidly becoming a social lifesaver. Over time, the pandemic shutdowns that were so necessary for public health would wreck countless businesses. But some would shine. Zoom's annual revenue went from $620 million in 2019 to $4.39 billion in 2022. And Abby was one of the millions of new users who helped account for that meteoric rise. On the other end of this particular link was Bob Williams, a knockabout local weed sprayer who'd come forward early to say he'd spent that whole week in the valley. Abby thanked him for his assistance. She opened with a little small talk and then showed him the picture of Russell Hill's Land Cruiser. Do you remember seeing it?
Oh, yeah, sure did.
5. Bob Williams was happy to keep chatting to Abby. He'd been up there in the valley with Wally Gibbs and Wayne Lawson. The three of them worked for a company that had a contract with Parks Victoria to carry out weed control in the Alpine National Park. They had driven in via the Zika spur track. They had a couple of four-wheel drives, plus a truck that carried large tanks of different sprays for different weeds on the back, along with some very long hoses. They'd arrived in Wonnangatta on Monday the 16th of March and set up camp close to the cemetery near the old homestead, planning to stay there the whole week. They did the blackberries first, along the side of the Zika spur.
Then 2 days later, they moved onto the flats along the Dry River Creek and sprayed Cape broom weeds, then the oxeye daisies. They saw three or four groups on the Monday. Nothing special. Some people waved a friendly greeting. No one stopped. They either camped along Conglomerate Creek or around the ruins of the old homestead. One bloke on the Wednesday stopped and had a chat. Me and Wally had just broke for lunch when he came along on his own, in a car with a trailer.
What sort of car?
Bob shrugged. They all blend together a bit. Maybe a Prado? White Prado. Think it was white. Biggish, older style four-wheel drive. To be honest, but I didn't really pay much attention to what he was driving because when he got out, I could see he was sweating and I thought to myself, fuck, just my luck. I come working out in the middle of nowhere and run into someone with COVID. Sheesh. So I took, like, a step back, you know, kept my distance.
What was he wearing?
Ooh, maybe shorts, blue singlet and gaiters. I remember the gaiters.
Gaiters?
For snakes. Leather gaiters that go from your boot halfway up your calf. He said he'd been deer hunting, which sort of made sense. You would want to wear gaiters if you were stalking something through this type of bush. There are copperheads everywhere. Anyway, we got chatting a bit and he wanted to know where a good camping spot was. There was already a few people along the Conglomerate Creek and around us near the homestead, so we said he should try Buck's Camp. That's off to the right from the Dry River track, maybe 3 or 4 k's away from the homestead. It's a nice spot, near the river.
Did he take your advice?
Yeah. Well, he did on the Wednesday. Must have driven straight there. We kept going along the side of the flats that arvo till the money for the oxeye daisies ran out. But by the end of the day, we were up near the turn off to Buck's Camp and we looked in and could see his trailer about 100 metres away, so he must have pulled in among the trees, back down close to the river. Bob and Wally had brief chats with a few other families on the Thursday.
Later on. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.